right? Whatever people love, whatever the people they enjoy, whatever it is, some people it's a hobby, whatever it is that you love talking about, whatever it is you love, you don't have any problem talking about it. So if witnessing is a struggle for you, or talking to people about the Lord is a struggle for you, well, instead of just focusing on talking, focus on getting the Lord in your heart more, and then it will come out. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. What's in your heart will come out. So if it's not coming out of your mouth, that's a symptom that it runs much deeper, and it's not in your heart. Well, take your Bibles this morning. That was just the introduction to the message. 2 Thessalonians chapter number 2. 2 Thessalonians chapter number 2. Our text for this morning is verses 9 through 12, but we're going to start in verse 1, get the whole context again. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse number 1. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? And now ye know what withholdeth that he might be revealed in his time. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Father, thank you for an opportunity to meet here today with your children, and we trust with you, Lord. And thank you for Jesus Christ going to the cross, Lord, once again, to pay for our sins. Lord, please help us this morning. Please help us to hear what you have to say to us, Lord, with open hearts, open minds, ready minds, ready to receive the truth that you want us to receive. Lord, we pray right now for our brother Paul Victor, laboring over there in India. We pray that for that, especially, Lord, for that trip coming up May 28th and 29th, that you'd prepare hearts to receive the gospel. Please have your hand of protection upon him and all the laborers that are going to be working that event. Please save many souls, Lord, that we could rejoice with them around your throne one day forever. And Lord, we look forward to that day. Lord, for us here this morning, help us, Lord, to be spiritually minded, to temporarily set aside whatever problems, issues, things we may be dealing with in this world, in this life, but we might wholeheartedly focus on you and on your word and the truth of your word this morning. I pray and ask that you would help me to teach and preach your word faithfully. I have absolutely no ability on my own to do this. I ask for your help, and I pray in Jesus' name, amen. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 says in verse 9, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. This morning, first, I'm going to teach the doctrinal meaning of this passage, specifically verses 9 to 12. Doctrinally, this has nothing to do with you and I today if you're saved. Doctrinally, this puts you forward into the time when after the man of sin has already been revealed, the rapture has already taken place, the Antichrist is on the throne, and God sends a strong delusion. So the first thing that I want to teach is I want to get the doctrine. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable. Number one, doctrine. So number one, we're going to get the doctrinal meaning of these verses, verses 9 to 12. And then I want to make some further application, how it applies to you today, whether you're saved or whether you're lost, and try to get some practical application for our fellowship with the Lord and our relationship with the Lord. There's an us and a them comparison in this chapter, just as we saw in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. If you remember in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, when the Lord talks about the day of the Lord, remember we went through that comparison? The day of the Lord is coming upon them. Sudden destruction is coming upon them. They, them. Everything about the day of the Lord has to do with them, not with us. He says, but let us who are of the day put on the breastplate of faith and love and all that. Same thing we have in this chapter. It's chapter 2, look at verse number 1. Now we beseech you, brethren, that's those that are saved. Verse number 2, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled. Let me tell you this morning, if you are not saved, if you're not part of the brethren, you have every reason to be troubled. You have every reason to be troubled, shaken in mind. If you have turned away the Son of God, you rejected Jesus Christ. The admonition to not be troubled or shaken in mind is not to those who have rejected Jesus Christ, but to those who have received Jesus Christ. Verse number 3, let no man deceive you by any means, the brethren. Verse number 5, remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things, and now ye know what withholdeth. Verse number 10. Now, watch how it changes. Verse number 10. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. If you're saved, if you're part of the brethren, you are not in the category of them that perish. Because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. Verse number 11, and for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Verse number 13, but we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation, through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. Praise the Lord. If you are in the brethren category, you have nothing to worry about as far as this strong delusion and damnation. It's not talking about you. It's not talking about us. It's talking about them. Praise the Lord for that. And honestly, folks, a lot of false doctrine, you know what it comes from? Well, it comes from people who don't want the truth. But it also comes from an inability to read the English language. them. How could you think that was talking about us? The damnation and the delusion comes on them. Salvation is for us who have trusted Jesus Christ. So before we get into this passage, if you're saved, I want to set your heart and your mind at ease that the damnation and the strong delusion that God is going to send has nothing to do with you. We are going to be gone. The Lord is coming before this happens on the earth. So praise the Lord for that. Look at verse number 9 again. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders. We'll talk more about that tonight. We'll focus on verse number 9 tonight. But the devil, how does he deceive the world into thinking he's God? He does it, power, signs, and lying wonders. So just because somebody has power doesn't mean they're of God. We'll talk about that more tonight. Verse number 10. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. Every single person that has ever been on this planet, ever walked this planet, God has given every single one of them a measure of truth and a measure of light. The fact that they didn't receive it proves that it was offered to them, but they didn't want it. They rejected it. In John chapter 1, verse number 9, it says about Jesus Christ, he came unto his own, and his own received him not. That means they had an opportunity to receive him. They had an opportunity to trust him, but they didn't want him. So these people here, they're in the time of Jacob's trouble. Antichrist is in the temple claiming to be God. God's sending strong delusion. And why do they fall for it? Because they didn't receive the love of the truth. They didn't receive it. That means it was presented to them, but they rejected it. And God is not a mean God. He is not an unreasonable God, as the Calvinists would have you believe. He is not arbitrarily assigning some people to heaven and some people to hell. Every single person that has ever walked this planet has been given some truth and some light. John chapter 1, verse number 11, the Bible says that was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. Every single man has been given a measure of light by God. Now, what you do and what I do with that light and with that truth depends on how much more truth God will give you. If you will not receive the light that the Lord has given you, then God is not obligated to give you any more light and any more truth. If you won't believe what he has told you, why would he tell you anything more? That works for lost people, that works for saved people. But every single person has been given light. Titus chapter 2 says, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. All men. You believe the Bible? Okay. The grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. All are without excuse. Romans chapter 1 verse number 20 says, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead. From the creation of the world, you can clearly see God's eternal power and Godhead. That's what the Bible says, so that they are without excuse. Nobody can say, I never knew, I was never told. God gave every man light. Every man is exposed to the grace of God that brings salvation. The creation of the world, you can clearly see God's eternal power and Godhead. The Bible says they are without excuse. Psalm 19, verses 1 to 3. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Every language there is on the earth, God speaks that language. He is speaking to them from his creation. Say, what about the people? It's always Africa. It's never, what about the people in America that have never heard? It's always, what about the people in Africa that have never heard? Or what about the people in some far out place in India or China? What about those people that have never heard? Everybody has heard. There is no language nor voice where their voice is not heard. The voice of God's creation is speaking to them, saying, somebody bigger and more powerful than you made this. And the Bible says if you believe that light, if you believe that truth, that God will give you more light and more truth. And eventually, the grace of God that bringeth salvation will appear unto you, and you will have an opportunity to be saved. Nobody is without excuse. But look at our passage again. It says in verse number 10, 2 Thessalonians 2:10, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness and them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. People are deceived when they choose unrighteousness over the truth. They're deceived when they just want to sin. They don't want anybody telling them they don't want anybody interfering with their sin. And if truth interferes with their sin, then they'll throw out the truth. And that's why they're saved. They're not saved because the deception was too strong. They're saved because they didn't want the truth. Now, we'll come back here. Get Revelation for me. Revelation 19 and Revelation 14. First, we got to get the doctrine of the passage. The doctrine of the passage points you forward in time. The time of Jacob's trouble. If you're saved, you won't be here for it. The time of Jacob's trouble. What did I say? Revelation 14? Yeah, Revelation 14 and Revelation 19. Get them both, if you would. The passage we're dealing with, the man of sin's been revealed. He's sitting on the temple of God. He's claiming to be God. And how does he deceive the world? Power, signs, lying wonders. And people are deceived. Why? Because they didn't want the truth. They received not the truth. I'm going to show you this. Revelation 14, let's just start in verse 1. Revelation 14, 1. And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Sion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of a great thunder. And I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps, and they sung as it were a new song before the throne and before the beasts and the elders. And no man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. So we won't turn there. Revelation chapter 7, the Lord seals 144,000 witnesses, and they go out and they preach and they witness for the Lord. And here in Revelation chapter 14, we see them. Now they're redeemed from the earth, they're up in heaven, they've been raptured. Verse number 4. These are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. Okay, before we move on. So you had, they're in heaven now, but for 3.5 years, it looks like, but for quite a length of time, you had 144,000 witnesses, the real Jehovah Witnesses. They're really witnesses for Jehovah, and they're preaching on the earth, 144,000 of them. Now look at verse 6. And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him. See what you just read? There's an angel flying in the midst of heaven, and he's preaching to all them on the earth, every nation, every kindred, every tongue, every people. That's not something you see every day. An angel flying through the midst of heaven and preaching at you in every language, every people. Verse number 7 says, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven, heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. And there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And the third angel followed them saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. And they have no rest day nor night who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. So, there are angels flying in heaven, and they are preaching to the men and the women, the people that dwelling on the earth. Are you getting the picture of this? Can you picture this in your mind? An angel flying through the midst of heaven and preaching so that everyone in the earth can hear him? That's not something you forget. That was after 144,000 witnesses going throughout the earth preaching. That was after all the seals and the trumpets and all the things in the Bible that Revelation talks about. It's all playing out just exactly as the Bible said it would. And there's an angel, and he says, if you take this mark, if you receive the number of his name, you are going to burn forever. No rest, no night, no light, no water. Now, look at Revelation 19. Revelation 19, 19. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against him that sat on the horse and against his army. And the beast was taken. No match for the Lord. The beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into a lake of fire burning with brimstone. Now here's what I want to bring out. The Bible says the Antichrist deceived the people that took the mark. He deceived them. Now, think about this, folks. Think about this. Time of Jacob's trouble. You have all these sealed judgments. You have these trumpets judgments. All these miraculous judgments of God on the earth playing out exactly as the Bible said they would. You have 144,000 witnesses going and preaching, male virgin Jews, just like the Bible said they would. And you have angels flying in the midst of heaven preaching. And one of them says, don't take the mark or you're going to burn in the lake of fire. If you got deceived and took the mark, it's because you wanted to be deceived. It's because you didn't want the truth when it was offered to you. Look, at everything's happening just like the Bible says it was. There's an angel flying into heaven warning you not to take the mark. If you got deceived, it's because you wanted to get deceived. It's because you didn't want the truth when it was offered to you. The Bible says in 2 Thessalonians 2, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. Why? Because they receive not the love of the truth. The truth was offered to them loud and clear, and they didn't want it. That's how they got deceived. So you say, oh, it's unfair. They were tricked. They were deceived. No, no. They were deceived because God offered them the truth, and they didn't want it. So God sent strong delusion that they should believe a lie. So God is not arbitrarily up in heaven deceiving people and tricking them. No, he offers them the truth. He wants them saved. And they didn't want the truth. Now, go back with me to 2 Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse number 10. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness, it's a tough word to say, deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish because they receive not the love of the truth. They didn't receive the love of the truth. You know, this generation, they're always talking about love, 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 love. You need more love. There's not enough love there. You need more love. While they turn away the greatest love this world's ever seen. The Bible says, God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. This generation talks about love, 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 not enough love, we need more love, and God offered his only begotten son to pay for your sins because he loved you, and they mock it and they scorn at it. Are you kidding me? You don't want love, you just want to sin. You don't want anybody interfering with your sin. It's not about love, you just want to do your own thing. Because you turned away the greatest love that this world's ever seen. So it's not about love. That's a cover. In other words, that's a cover saying, I just want to sin, and anybody who stands against my sin is unloving. No, it's not about love. It's about the truth. You didn't receive the love of the truth. Now, look at verse number 11. The Bible says, and for this cause God shall send them strong delusion. God doesn't send strong delusion arbitrarily like the Calvinists. Look, like the Calvinists teach. Look, everywhere you see God sending strong delusion or God hardened Pharaoh's heart, every single one of those examples is a response to that man saying, God, I don't want you and I don't want your truth. Every single time. The Bible says in verse 11, and for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion. In other words, you didn't believe my Bible. You didn't believe the angels that I sent to preach to you. Everything that you saw happened just according to my book. You didn't believe any of that. Well, it's clear that you didn't want the truth. So here's a lie for you. Here's a lie for you. And that's, folks, that's the doctrinal meaning of this passage. Look, it says in verse 11, and for this cause, God shall send them strong delusion. Yeah, it's going to take a strong delusion for them to fall for that after they were warned by an angel flying in the midst of heaven, like the Bible said. It's going to take a strong delusion for them to fall for that. But they made it loud and clear to God. They didn't want the truth, that they should believe a lie. Verse number 12, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth. There it is, but had pleasure and unrighteousness. And there's the heart of the matter. It's not about love. It's not about truth. It's just, I want to sin. I don't want to tell anyone telling me not to sin. And that's the heart of the matter right there. That they all might be damned. That's not a curse word. That's the destination of everybody who rejects Jesus Christ. Damned, damnation. Now, go with me. Hold your finger here. Go to Isaiah 66. We'll come back. Isaiah 66. But hold your finger right there. Isaiah 66. If God forced people to believe and he forced people to repent, men would shake their fist at him saying he's a cruel dictator. He's a cruel monarch. They don't let him sin. They don't let him do anything. So God gives them a free will. And then they blame God for all the bad things that are going on. This is the result of your free will. This world is a result of man doing what man wants to do. Isaiah 66, verse number 1. Thus saith the Lord, the heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that ye build unto me? And where is the place of my rest? For all those things hath mine hand made, and all those things have been, saith the Lord, but to this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit, and trembleth at my word. You know, there's not much trembling at the word of God these days, not among the saved or the lost. That's really, really lacking. When was the last, let me ask you a question, I'm going to ask myself at the same time. When was the last time that you trembled at the Word of God because the Word of God said this and you knew you weren't doing it, or the Word of God said don't do this and you knew you weren't doing that? When was the last time that that actually caused you to tremble? I am violating the law of the God of the universe. Verse number 3. He that killeth an ox is as if he slew a man. He that sacrificeth a lamb as if he cut off a dog's neck. In other words, Lord saying, I'm not accepting your sacrifices the way you're living. He says, he that offereth an oblation as if he offered swine's blood, he that burneth incense as if he blessed an idol. Look at that. Yea, they have chosen their own ways, and their soul delighteth in their abominations. Verse 4, I also will choose their delusions. See that? The Lord says, I'm going to choose their delusions. In other words, I'm going to choose how I'm going to deceive them, but I'm not the one that started it. I am choosing their delusions. I also will choose their delusions in a response to them choosing their own ways and delighting in their abominations. That's exactly what we saw in 2 Thessalonians 2, deceivableness of unrighteousness. They had pleasure in unrighteousness, so God sent the strong delusion. These people delighted in their abominations. They chose their own ways. So the Lord says, well, I'm going to choose something too. I will choose their own delusions, their delusions, and will bring their fears upon them. Now watch this. Because when I called, none did answer. When I spake, they did not hear. But they did evil before mine eyes and chose that in which I delighted not. I called and they didn't answer, so when they call, I'm not going to answer them. Lord will give you what you want. He's a perfect gentleman. You want sin, he'll let you believe a lie. He'll let you have sin and everything that goes along with that. You want righteousness? He'll give you everything that goes along with that. That's a great and blessed way. Go back to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Now some say that if you heard the gospel prior to the rapture and didn't get saved, that you were going to be sent this strong delusion. To me it seems the point of no return, if you will, is that midpoint when the Antichrist sets up as claims to be God. But it's we're not going to argue about that. I'm not 100% sure about that. But if you're lost, I wouldn't take a chance. I get saved today. Why would you wait another day? But 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse number 11 says, "For this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie." Now that's the doctrine. So far what we've covered is the doctrinal meaning of these verses. The doctrinal meaning puts you forward into the time of Jacob's trouble. The man of sin's revealed. He sits on the temple of Jerusalem, claims to be God. Everybody that was deceived because they didn't want the truth, they're going to be damned, thrown into the lake of fire. That's the context. We're talking about the man of sin and the time of tribulation. But we need to get some practical application for us today, whether you're saved or you're lost. So go back to 1 Kings chapter 22. 1 Kings 22. 1 Kings 22 illustrates in detail the truth of 2 Thessalonians 2 that we just covered. So we're going to go through it. 1 Kings 22. First Kings 22, verse number 1. And they continued 3 years without war between Syria and Israel. And it came to pass in the third year that Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, came down to the king of Israel. And the king of Israel said unto his servants, "Know ye that Ramoth and Gilead is ours?" Well, no, I didn't know that, but now that you told me, sure. "Know ye that Ramoth and Gilead is ours, and we be still, and take it not out of the hand of the king of Syria?" And so the king of Israel is saying, listen, Ramoth and Gilead really belongs to us, but the Syrians have control of it, so we need to go take it back. Verse number 4. And he said unto Jehoshaphat, "Wilt thou go with me to battle to Ramoth Gilead?" And Jehoshaphat said to the king of Israel, "I am as thou art, my people as thy people, my horses as thy horses." So the king of Israel, which is Ahab at this time, he asked Jehoshaphat for help to go fight against Syria. He says, "Will you help me?" Jehoshaphat says, "Absolutely, absolutely, I'm with you, my people, thy people, I'm right with you in the battle." Verse number 5, and Jehoshaphat said unto the king of Israel, "Inquire, I pray thee, at the word of the Lord today." Well, that's the question you should have asked before you said you were going, Jehoshaphat. Why are you inquiring at the word of the Lord when you've already made up your mind on what you're going to do? What is the point of asking God for direction when you already made up your mind what you're going to do? "Inquire, I pray, at the word of the Lord today." Why? You already said you were going. What difference does it make? And that's what people do. They make their own plans, they come up with their own ideas, they say, "This is what I'm going to do. Now let's see if I can get God's stamp of approval so I can feel good about it and not feel bad about it, but either way I'm going to do it." And that's the attitude. You want guidance, you want direction from God, you want guidance from God. You don't say, "Lord, this is what I'm going to do, is this okay?" And if he doesn't send a lightning bolt to strike you down, you take that as a yes. No, you say, "Lord, what do you want me to do? Whatever it is, I'll do it if you'll just show me the way." But Jehoshaphat did what most people do. He already decided what he was going to do, and then he asked the Lord about it. Verse number 6. Then the king of Israel gathered the prophets together, about 400 men, and said unto them, Shall I go against Ramoth-Gilead to battle, or shall I forbear? And they said, Go up, for the Lord shall deliver it into the hand of the king. Now these are false prophets, specially picked by Ahab, who already knew the answer ahead of time. And how convenient. And people, you know what they do today? They go to the church of their choice, where they already know that what is going to be said is not going to violate what they want to do. They don't want to go to the wise. They don't want to go anywhere that's actually going to tell them the truth. They go somewhere where everything that man says up there, I already know it's going to be exactly what I want to hear. And that's what Ahab's doing here. Verse number 7. And Jehoshaphat said, Is there not here a prophet of the Lord besides, that we might inquire of him? Now, Jehoshaphat's a good king. He's got some problems linking up with Ahab here. But overall, he's a good king. And he says, What are you consulting these guys for? How about a prophet of the Lord? Verse number 8. And the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, There is yet one man, Micaiah the son of Imlah, by whom we may inquire of the Lord, but I hate him. For he doth not prophesy good concerning me, but evil. And Jehoshaphat said, Let not the king say so. In other words, Ahab knew where to go if he wanted the truth, but that's not what he wanted to hear. He wasn't interested in what's right. He wasn't interested in the truth. He was interested in something that sounded good to him. And you get to the place where you're not interested in truth. You get to the place where you don't want to hear from the Lord. You just want someone to help you feel good. You're about done. Your Christian walk's about done. Your fellowship with the Lord's about done when you get to that point. Verse number 9. Then the king of Israel called an officer and said, Hasten hither Micaiah, the son of Imlah. So he's got some pressure from Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat said, I'm already going to go with you. So, well, he already said he's going to go with me. So let's just appease him. We'll call Micaiah. Verse number 10. And the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, sat each on his throne, having put on their robes in a void place in the entrance of the gate of Samaria. And all the prophets prophesied before them. And Zedekiah, the son of Chenene, I think that's how you pronounce it. Who's going to correct me? Zedekiah, the son of Chenene, made him horns of iron, and he said, Thus saith the Lord, with these shalt thou push the Syrians until thou have consumed them. They got the props all set up. Looks, it's a really nice show. These horns, this is what's going to do it here, king. Verse 12. And all the prophets prophesied so, saying, Go up to Ramoth-Gilead and prosper, for the Lord shall deliver it into the king's hand. They never asked the Lord. They never inquired at the Lord. They just assumed they knew what the Lord would say. Verse number 13. And the messenger that was gone to call Micaiah spake unto him, saying, Behold now, the words of the prophets declare good unto the king with one mouth. Let thy word, I pray thee, be like the word of one of them, and speak that which is good. Good, 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 good. Nothing, no regard for what's right, no regard for what's true. Just make sure it sounds good, Micaiah. Very, very modern. Verse number 14. And Micaiah said, As the Lord liveth, what the Lord saith unto me, that will I speak. Now that's the right attitude. Whatever the Lord tells me, that's what I'm going to tell you. Verse 15. So he came to the king, and the king said unto him, Micaiah, Shall we go against Ramoth-Gilead to battle, or shall we forbear? And he answered him, Go and prosper, for the Lord shall deliver it into the hand of the king. Now, that's interesting. I don't know if Micaiah was doing that mockingly, or he had a slight moment of weakness there, but look at the response, verse 16. And the king said unto him, How many times shall I adjure thee that thou tell me nothing but that which is true in the name of the Lord? Well, since when have you ever wanted truth, Ahab? Now, why didn't he accept that answer from Micaiah when he did accept it from all the other prophets? Because the reason he went to the other prophets is because he already knew they were going to lie to him. That's what he wanted. You know why people go to a church where they know the Bible's not preached and they know the Bible's not taught? They don't want the truth. They want to be lied to. They want to be deceived because at least they'll be comfortable doing what they're doing. That's why they go. And he took it from the false prophets, but he's not taking it from Micaiah. He says, look, he just showed his hand. You know what he just said? Micaiah, I know this is not the real message from the Lord. If the Lord was actually going to speak to me, this is not what he's saying. You're lying, Micaiah. You can't say that. Everybody else can say that. You can't say that. That's interesting, huh? You know, if I got up here this morning and I told all you folks, and I said, you know, no matter what you do, no matter how you live, no matter how you choose to live your life, the main thing is that you are happy, and no matter what, God's going to bless your life. You would say, hit the road. What are you lying to us for? Okay, well, if you wouldn't take it from me, why would you take it from somebody else? If somebody's lying, they're lying. But, so what do people go to what they want. If they want the truth, they know where to find it. If they want to be lied to, they know where to find that. Verse 17. And he said, that's Micaiah, I saw all Israel scattered. Now he's going to give them the real truth. I saw all Israel scattered upon the hills as a sheep that have not a shepherd. And the Lord said, these have no master. Let them return every man to his house in peace. You know what he just said? He said, King, you're going to die. All the Israel, they have no master. They have no shepherd. You know what that means? That means the king's dead. Verse 18. And the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, did I not tell thee that he would prophesy no good concerning me but evil? I told you this was going to happen. This is why I didn't want to call him. I knew what he'd say ahead of time. It wasn't going to be anything positive regarding me. Right? Verse number 19. Micaiah continues with his message from the Lord. And he says, and he said, hear thou therefore the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne up in heaven, and all the host of heaven standing by him on his right hand and on his left. And the Lord said, who shall persuade Ahab that he may go up and fall at Ramoth-Gilead? And one said on this manner, and another said on that manner. See what's going on? It's a wild scene. Lord's up in heaven. All the host of heaven, the angels, all the spirits, whatever beings he's got up there, all the host of heaven's right there. And he says, I need a volunteer. Because I've had it with Ahab. He's done. I need somebody to go down here and convince him to go to Ramoth-Gilead so he can fall and be killed. Anybody got an idea? Now, when was the last time you heard that God presented? If it wasn't from somebody who believed this book. When was the last time you turned the dial on the radio or turned on the religious TV and heard that God presented? Verse number 21. And there came forth a spirit and stood before the Lord and said, I will persuade him. And the Lord said unto him, wherewith? And he said, I will go forth and I will be a lying spirit and the mouth of all his prophets. And he said, thou shalt persuade him and prevail also. Go forth and do so. The Lord says, go ahead, do your thing. Verse 23. Now therefore, behold, the Lord hath put a lying spirit and the mouth of all these thy prophets, and the Lord has spoken evil concerning thee. Now, we won't read the rest of the chapter, but Ahab goes to Ramoth-Gilead, and he's killed by an arrow, and he dies, just like the Lord said would happen. Now, you see what happened? You see what happened here? This is an illustration in detail of the truth of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. You know why? He was deceived, right? The Lord put a lying spirit in the mouth of his prophets to convince him to go to Ramoth-Gilead so he could fall and die. Will you say, how mean, how evil of the Lord to do so? No! Ahab proved conclusively he didn't want the truth. He knew where he could get the truth, and he didn't want to call the man. He knew Micaiah was the one to call, would be the one to tell him the truth, and he didn't want Micaiah. He wanted the 400 false prophets. And when Micaiah did come, he says, now you tell me what's true. And Micaiah told him what's true, and he says, that's not what I wanted to hear. And he does what he wants to do anyways. That's the truth of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. God sent the lying spirit. God sends strong delusion. But it's only in response to people who have made it absolutely clear they don't want the truth. So if you're lost in here today, the truth is very plain, it's very clear. Jesus Christ died to pay for your sins. He was buried. He rose again the third day. And if you'll trust him, you can have eternal life. But if you don't want the truth, then you're going to fall for something else. And it doesn't matter what it is. There's plenty of other lies out there. Pick one, doesn't matter. You're going to fall for something else. Not because the delusion and the deception was too strong, but because when God offered the truth, you didn't want it. And that's the truth of 2 Thessalonians chapter number 2. Now, go back with me there. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Now that's, like I said, that'll work for the lost, that'll work for saved. If you're lost and you don't want the truth, God will let you believe a lie and you can burn in the lake of fire. Not because he didn't want to save you. And the devil doesn't even have power to deceive you if you wanted the truth. Look, if you want to get saved, nothing can stop you from getting saved. The devil can't stop you. His deception only works on people who don't want the truth. So if you want to get saved, you can get saved. That's the application to the lost. Now how about us that are saved? Because this has a lot of application to us too. God gives us truth, doesn't he? He gives us things he wants us to do, doesn't he? He continues to work on us, doesn't he? Our response to his workings in our life work the same way. Now you can't lose your salvation. You are saved. You are going to be saved forever. You're going to spend forever with the Lord. But you can certainly make shipwreck of your faith and of your Christian walk. And this truth right here, not because I'm saying or I'm preaching it, no. The truth of the Word of God that we're talking about right here, I don't know if there's any more truth that you could get as far as your relationship to the Lord. Because your relationship to the Lord depends on your obedience to Him. When He tells you to do something, you better do it. And if you turn away, here's how it goes. Here's how it goes, folks, for us that are saved. Lord gives us truth. We receive it, we believe it, we apply it to our lives, God blesses it, and then he gives us more truth. We receive it, we believe it, we apply it, praise the Lord, things are going well, then he gives us more truth, and then, eventually, he gives us a truth that we don't want to do. Eventually, it was praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, this is great, oh no, I don't want to do that. And then there's a point of controversy between you and the Lord, and that's decision time. Where are you going to go from there? And here's what we want to do. Every one of us, we all do it. Every one of us, the Lord teaches us. He instructs us. He says, this is what I want you to do. This is what I want you to apply to your life. And until it comes to a point when it crosses what you want to do or something you believe or how you think, and then you say, Lord, I'm not doing that. Not doing it. And then guess what? The truth stops and the light stops. The light stops, the truth stops, his sweet fellowship stops, his guiding hand stops until you deal with that. Now, here's what we want to do. We want to put that on hold and say, well, I'm not doing that. Maybe later sometime. Lord, can you give me some more truth? I'm going to set that aside for now because I don't really want to deal with that. How about some more truth, Lord? Lord says, no, you're not getting any more truth till you deal with that. Whatever that is, you got to deal with that before you go on. And we want to say, no, I don't want to do that. What else do you have for me? Lord says, I don't have anything else for you. You got to deal with that. I've told you time and time again to deal with that. We're not going on until you deal with that. Now, you can deceive yourself into think that God is, because God is blessing you and he's taking care of you materially or financially or health-wise, whatever the case may be, you think, and what do you, but you think, well, I must be okay with God because look how he's blessing me. 1 Timothy chapter 6 says that supposing gain is godliness, and that's wrong. That's not how it works. Your relationship with the Lord is not based on your material or physical condition. It's based on if your conduct matches the Word of God. So what do we do? We say, Lord tells us, we know he's been honest, whatever it is. He's been honest. This is what I want you to do. This is what I want you to repent of. This is what I want to apply to your life. No, no, no. Let's move on. We'll come back to that later. No, you got to deal with that now. Now, Lord, Jonah, take Jonah. Life of Jonah is a great illustration of this truth. Jonah was a great prophet. Great prophet. Prophesying, serving the Lord. And then one day, Lord gives him some instruction, he doesn't want to do. He said, I want you to go to Nineveh. I want you to preach to Nineveh. Now, Nineveh is the capital of Assyria. Assyria, about that time, is the nation that took away Israel, the northern tribes, into captivity. Assyria is the one that took Jonah's people into captivity. Jonah has no love for the Assyrians. Jonah doesn't want to preach to them because he knows God's merciful and gracious, and he doesn't want those people to have any mercy or any grace. Jonah says, I'm not going. Lord said, you need to go to Nineveh. Jonah said, not doing it. And he goes down to Joppa, goes down to Tarshish, and you know what Jonah wants? Okay, Lord, I'm your servant. I'm your minister. I'm your prophet. Let's continue on. What else do you have for me? Lord said, I don't have anything else for you. You go back to Nineveh, or you're done. You don't have any more ministry until you go back to Nineveh. So Jonah said, not going. He gets on a ship, and you know what happens. The sailors throw him overboard. He says, I know God's been on me. I know this is all my fault. You just throw me overboard. He gets thrown overboard, swallowed by a whale. Now God in his mercy, he gives Jonah a second chance. Praise the Lord for second chances and third and fourth and fifth and sixth chances. And the Lord said, he vomits Jonah back up on the dry land. Jonah gets a second chance. To do what? Not to do something else, a second chance to go back to Nineveh. See, you can't get away from it. You can't bypass it. If the Lord's on you to do something, you got to deal with that thing. Jonah would have had no more ministry until he went to Nineveh. You got to deal with what the Lord's telling you to do. I don't have to name anything. You know what the Lord's on you about. You know what he's trying to work in your life about. You know what he's been telling you. I don't have to name anything. You know what the Lord's dealing with you. And you know what the Lord's saying? Until you deal with what I'm dealing with you, there is no more guidance. There is no more light. There is no more truth. Oh, sure, you can learn some more facts about the Bible and you can be blessed and all that. But you want God's leading hand of direction. You want his guidance. You want that sweet fellowship with the Lord. You got to do what he's been on you about. You got to deal with that, or there is no more going forward after that. Go with me to Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2. See, you know what Jonah wanted? He wanted to just continue on his ministry and say, Lord, you just chalked this up to something I failed in, something I could have done better, and nobody hits it 100% of the time. We'll just go on like that. That's what we want to do, right? God tells us to do something. We don't want to do it. What is our response in our heart? We may not say it out loud, but in our heart, what's the response? Well, Lord, nobody's perfect. You just chalked this up to something I could have done better, but let's go on, Lord. The Lord said, no, we are not going on. Not as far as your relationship with him is concerned. We are not going on until you deal with that. Whatever that is. Luke chapter 2, look at verse number 41. Luke 2, 41. Now his parents, that's Jesus, Jesus' parents, went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast. And when they had fulfilled the days, as they returned, the child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother knew not of it. But they, supposing him to have been in the company, went a day's journey, and they sought him among their kinsfolk and acquaintance. So Jesus' parents, they're done in Jerusalem. They turn to head home to their city of Nazareth, but they just suppose. They assume Jesus is still with them, but they don't bother to check. They just assume, well, he's been with us all these years. Surely he's still with us. And they don't check, they assume, and they go back, and then they realize, oh, he's not here. And they look for him among their kinsfolk and the family and acquaintance. Oh, he's not here. He's not with us. And how many times have you and I, we go through our daily walk, we go through our life, we get up in the morning, we just assume, well, I've been walking with God all these years. I've had his presence all these years. Whatever I do, he must approve of. And we just go on about our day, assuming he's with us, and we've left him behind. Now, he's with you, in a doctrinal sense, he'll never leave you or forsake you if you're saved. But I'm talking about his presence. I'm talking about that relationship. That relationship with the Lord. You can leave Jesus behind and not even know it because you're busy, your mind's on other things. They're looking for him. He's not there. They left him back there. Verse number 45. And when they found him not, they turned back again. See that? They turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him. And it came to pass that after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the doctors, both hearing them and asking them questions. When they realized that Jesus' presence was no longer there, when they realized that he was not right next to him like he had been, you know what they had to do? They had to go back to the place where they left him. They had to go back to the place where the last time he was with them, they couldn't go forward, they had to go back. And folks, what a lesson. What a lesson for you and I today. See, here's what happens. There's a point of controversy between you and the Lord. He tells you to do something, you know he's been on you to do something, and you say, not doing it. And you go on. Could be days, months, years. I mean, however long it takes for you to realize Jesus isn't here. That sweet relationship is gone. However long it takes you to realize, and you say, where is he? Where's the guidance? Where's the light? Where's the direction? He's not here. You know what you want? You want him to meet you in a path up ahead somewhere where your paths are going to meet. And the Lord says, no, you can't do that. If you've left Jesus behind, you have to go back to the place that you left him. Back to the place where you had the sweet fellowship. Back to the place where his guidance was there and it was real. Where was that place? You have to go back. Somewhere you left Jesus behind. That there was a point of controversy. He said, go right. You went left and you went on ahead. And there, those trails do not meet up. You have to go back again. You have to retrace your steps. You have to go back to where you left him if you want his presence again. Now, some people have gone so far ahead, they can't get quite back to that place where they left him. But here's what you need to do. You need to go back. If that's your case, you need to go back as far as you possibly can. And when you get there, you say, this is where I messed up. This is where I sinned. You don't make excuses for it. You don't justify it. You acknowledge it for what it is. And you say, Lord, I've gone back as far as I can go back. Will you help me from here? And the Lord will meet you there. And you can continue on from there in sweet fellowship and sweet communion. But as long as you're going on ahead and hoping he meets up with you somewhere along the way, it's not going to happen. You need to go back to the place where you left him, back to the place where you had that sweet fellowship, and you need to go back to there, wherever that was. That's the application of you and I today as a saved person. You will not be damned. You will not lose your salvation. But you will lose that sweet fellowship relationship with the Lord. And why? Why? Because the Lord says, here's some truth that I want to give you. And you said, that's not the truth I want to receive. See? Receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. If you're lost in here today, God is giving you God is giving you the truth of the gospel. That's the only thing you need. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, you don't need any of this stuff, the relationship, all this stuff, doesn't matter. You need to receive Jesus Christ. That's the truth that God is giving you. If you're saved in here today, well, you know better than I do. I don't know what it is. There's something in your life Lord's trying to deal with you. And you are not going on in your walk with him until you go back and deal with that and get it right. Whatever that is, you need to go back to the place that you left Jesus. And he'll meet you there. He'll meet you there. Father, thank you for an opportunity to open up your word today. Please bless the preaching, the hearing of it. Lord, may we trust you. I guess that's what it comes down to, Lord, in all of our lives. There's a point of controversy, and we just don't trust you enough that you love us. We just don't trust you enough that you know best. We just don't trust you that your ways really are higher than our ways and your thoughts than our thoughts. I guess that's really what it comes down to. Help us, Lord, to trust you more and to know the sweet, abiding fellowship and guidance of your light. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.